Hey everyone, GamingNoodle here, and we are going to be finishing off this wonderful game, Darksiders. We are now on a quest to get all the pieces of the sword that we need to destroy, well, the destroyer. And that was one of them. As soon as you cross the bridge that was in front of you, it will be there. As long as you have the mask on, the mask of, what is it, truth? Something? As long as you have that on, you will be able to see it. Once you grab it, go ahead and jump down and ride all the way across, because we're going to go to Volgrim and we're going to get out of here. Please follow what I do exactly, because I have it worked out where to go, when to port where. You know, I've got a nice kind of little route that I'm going to take that will get us through every single area that we need to go to get our wrath core, like I just got there, to get all the life shards, and to get all the pieces of the sword. I did buy the scythe there. You don't actually need to, like, you can use a code. There is a code you can put in the game to get a scythe for free, so you don't actually have to waste souls to buy it. It's up to you. I didn't really want to put it in the code, I just wanted to kind of earn everything myself, but if you want to, there is a place in the menu where you input a code and then just type, I think it's the hollowed one with spaces in between each word, I think that's what it is, and if you put that in, it will give you the scythe for free. So go ahead and do that if you like. Our first one, as long as you've gone through the right porthole, you're going to need to have your mask on. If you don't have the mask on, you won't be able to see the red orbs, and then you just will miss the bit that you need to get to. Yeah, so we are going to, once we go through here, we will be seeing a familiar face again, and the story will progress. Once that's finished, once we have gone through that bit, I'll try to talk about what my thoughts are, because to be honest, I haven't really looked online about like the storyline and stuff. I really should have, but like I have my own thoughts at the moment of like what I understood the story to be and what was going on and everything, and there's a few things I'm not quite sure on, and you know, so I guess I'll just talk about those things as we play through and we start going around collecting everything. I think that would be the best way to go about it, because I do find it interesting. I do find the story interesting. I would like to know a few more things that I don't think we'll get to find out until perhaps Darksiders 2 or whatever else comes out after that. We'll see. But once we're out here, go to the Anvil Fjord. If you can't go to Anvil Fjord, like I mean, before you go to Anvil Fjord, there is one thing you could do at Tiamat's castle that I didn't do purposely, because it'll just kind of make the video a little longer than it needs to be. If you move out and then you turn right and then you keep running right, you're gonna eventually see little kind of things in the sky, like these things here, where you can hookshot onto. And if you hookshot along, I think there's a chest or something, I can't remember, but there's also a mini fight that you have with this very interesting kind of Easter egg villain. It's a zombie in a top hat and a cane who has a very posh accent, and yeah, you fight him, which is very odd, but you go ahead and do that if you want. But make sure once you do that, you go to Anvil Fjord and you use the hookshot to the left, like I just did here, to get the chest before moving onwards. But if you would like, go ahead and do that. I didn't really see a point to doing it, because it doesn't really... I'm talking about the zombie fight with the top hat. I didn't see a point to doing that, because it doesn't really help with the 100% complete playthrough. And I know I have gotten a few chests here and there that I didn't really need to get for the 100%, but because it was along the way, I decided to get it anyway. So, and that thing was a bit too much out of the way for me to bother, really. This one's a very easy one. As soon as you go in, you turn around, and it's like right behind you. So it's very easy. And then once you get that, go ahead and make your way out. But yeah, we need to make it to. We need to go to the dry road. The dry roads to trigger the events of the story. So then we can get to see a bit more of what's happening. As usual, once it does start, I'm going to stop talking so that you can indeed listen to what's being said and enjoy the cutscene and the story. And yeah, we can go from there. Let's see how long it's going to take. So we're at the dry roads now, that's good. Just go ahead and jump across to the slimy wall. And it should cut any second now, really? Come on. Where are you? There we go. Okay, enjoy.
This is no ambush, horseman. I come alone. I, Uriel of the Hellguard, champion of the White City, call you, horseman, to Nex Sacramentum.
Fool.
I lay claim to your life before the Creator. Will you dishonor this law as well?
Why?
Because Abaddon said you understood honor, and because he was the best of us.
The death oath cannot be broken until one falls by the hand of the other. I accept.
Alright, well, that was interesting. This isn't going to be too much of a tough fight, where it shouldn't be. You're going to have this fight with Uriel once again. She really has it out for you. Ever since Abaddon died, she's been on your case. She's been on your case for ever since. I mean, like, how much time passed? Apparently, like, I can't remember how many years, but it was many, many years had passed from the time that, like, right at the beginning, where we see Abaddon die from Straga, to when we leave the Council and we go back to Earth. Like, many, many years had passed. Well, it's obvious because, I mean, look at the Earth that we're in. It's post... I mean, it's... the apocalypse has happened. Everyone is dead. Like I said before, it kind of makes it feel a bit empty and everything, but anyway, that's besides the point. The world is basically... all the humans have died, I think. Because we don't really see any, do we? All we see are angels, demons, and all the monsters in between, but no humans. So, yeah, just when it comes to this sword throwing stuff, just kind of keep moving around to try and not get hit. When you move around, dodge as much as you can, but don't dodge into them, because you will get hurt. It's no good. Again, there's a lot of startup animations. You can see her wind up, jump in the air, and then slam down. Plenty of time to move out of the way, and then rush back in and do some damage. She does do this sword throwing a lot. It's, again, it's fine though. You just kind of keep moving around. There is, I think there's one move where she does slam down and then like electricity comes out of her for a few waves, and I think that's a very dangerous move that you have to avoid just by staying back and waiting. But I should be close to killing her now. She's taking quite a bit of damage. Should be finishing soon enough. And yeah, we'll get to see more of the story. She is pretty cool. I do her character. It's kind of like Storm from X. All right, I'll carry on talking afterwards.
Yes, yes. What are you waiting for? Harvest this wench. War? Don't you dare walk away from me.
Sacramentum is mine. I decide when the angel dies, not you.
You swore an oath to me.
Abaddon is the destroyer.
Liar!
To protect you, he kept you from the truth. You pledged to follow your lord into hell, never knowing what awaited you, or what he would become.
Abaddon.
He was betrayed and became the enemy of all creation. I've been to the tree. Its gift was truth. And I share it with you now. Remember the death oath. Soon it must be fulfilled.
Well, there you go. She didn't seem too happy hearing that. I'll be talking about the storyline, but again, just kind of follow where I'm going. Make sure that you have your mask ready and get that next piece. Again, if you see me grabbing a chest or an item or something and for some reason it's not visible on your screen, it probably means you haven't got your mask on and you should put the mask on to see it. We're going to be moving up through this way. Anyway, go ahead and follow that. But I want to now talk about what exactly has happened and, you know, what might happen. Basically, okay, so we start out with angels and demons at the beginning of the game. They're all crashing down and fighting each other, and then they start, you know, the demons start like hunting down the humans as well, like in the beginning of the beginning movie. And then war arrives as well among them, and that's when we come in and we get to control them, and we start killing both, really. We're killing angels and demons, and the angels are like saying, oh, war is here, like it's a big surprise. So that's like the first kind of, you know, like, okay, so what? War should be here. It's the apocalypse. That's what happens. But then we see Abaddon, who, when he sees us, let me just say that, there we go, that's one of the legendaries. It's a very good one. I think I'm going to use that because it's great. So we get that nice and quick. Anyway, Abaddon sees us and he's like, oh, you know, the seventh seal wasn't broken. Now, the whole seals thing, I do know that in biblical terms, you know, this whole story is from the Bible. I think the New Testament it is. Basically, you know, the four horsemen of the apocalypse itself, the whole seals thing, it says that, you know, God had a book that had seven seals, and when all the seals were broken, it was basically, you know, the apocalypse that was going to happen on Earth. Everything went to shit. But the thing is, Abaddon tells you that, oh, the seventh seal was unbroken, so he doesn't know why war is there. Which kind of confused me a bit, because at least in biblical terms, when the first four seals were broken, that is when the horsemen arrived. One seal for each horseman. And so when the first four were broken, that's when you get them. And then when the fifth, sixth, and seventh and all that, when they broke, that's when everything bad happened. Like, you know, the sun went black or dark or something, and like there was floods and all sorts of horrible things going on. So you would think that even though six of the seven seals in Darksiders were broken, that they should expect the horsemen to arrive. But I guess not. I guess in this game, only after all seven seals are broken should the horsemen arrive, and should the apocalypse happen, Armageddon, complete Armageddon. So I guess, okay, fine. But then I was wondering, well, if that's the case, then yeah, why did war come to Earth? Who called him? Who's supposed to call him? Is it the council? The Charred Council? Because apparently he works for them, right? So then I guess they would be the ones to tell him that, okay, now it's your time to go to Earth because the seals are broken. But no, but he still went anyway. But he doesn't just go by himself. He said he was called, but we don't know what was the call. Like, because if the seventh seal was still intact, then what was the mechanism that triggered the event for him to say, oh, okay, it's now my time to go down to Earth because it's the apocalypse. So I don't understand what happened there. You know, even if it was a mistake, whose mistake was it? I don't get it. But apparently, War gets blamed because the fact that he's there on Earth and people see him, they're like, okay, the demons are here now and the angels are fighting with them because you're here. Even though that doesn't really make sense because they were fighting beforehand, but then even War says that when he goes back in front of the council and they tell him why he went when the seventh seal wasn't broken and why did he start the war, he's like, it already happened before I went there. So again, like, I would like to know why or who told him that it was time to, like, he was being summoned. It'd be nice to know that. Maybe that's one of the things that's going to be explained. Maybe in Darksiders 2, I don't know. Who knows? But in Darksiders 2, we're going to be playing not as War, but as Death, which is another horseman, and I guess War's brother. So maybe when we're playing through Death's, you know, we're seeing Death's side, we might get to see what happened and maybe why War was sent and not him and the other two. Because again, in this game, we're just playing as War. We don't see where the other horsemen are, and when you're summoned, it's not just summoned like they're all supposed to be summoned to, you know, ride across the lands and do what they have to do. So, but I think Darksiders 2, when you play as Death, I think his story in that game is happening at the same time as this story. I think it's supposed to be happening at, like, side by side. I'm not sure on that, but I think that's what's happening. Again, I'm just curious, and I can't wait to see what happens. And there we have another shard of the sword. Always good. But yeah, so hopefully that will be answered. So now, but now that the Charred Council are saying, okay, well, it's, you know, if it's not your fault, whose is it? If you can't give us an answer, we're gonna have to blame you for it, because, you know, you were there, everyone saw you. Perhaps you were conspiring with the demons, and then, you know, once they had used you for whatever need they had, they discarded you. Which is why you almost died to Straga. Which also reminds me, remember when we were playing at the beginning? When you're as War, you actually have full powers, and then that horn keeps sounding, and every time the horn sounded, you lost major health and powers and stuff, until basically it happened right at the end when you're facing Straga, until you were nothing. That's why Straga got to, like, almost kill you, because for some reason that horn that sounded sapped away all your health. So I don't know who, like, what that signifies, like, who had the power to take away War's strength like that. So I don't know where the horn came from. It was just there and it happened. But anyway, so, you know, then as War, we tell the council, okay, well, send me back to Earth. I want to find out who did this to me, who set me up. And they're like, well, no, because what's the point? You know, you're so weak now, you're probably useless. And he's like, well, if I'm so useless and weak, then the demons will kill me anyway, and that's what you want, so it's win-win for you, I guess. So they're like, okay, fine, we'll let you go back to Earth and see what you can do, see if you can find out what happened. And that's what happens. We go to Earth, we have that shadow guy that's with us throughout the whole game as, like, a watchdog to make sure that, I guess, we don't get out of line or something, I don't know. But he's just a nuisance. By the way, this section is very important that you switch quickly between your weapons. You need to make sure you have your mask on so you can get on the red orbs, and then you have to switch quickly to the hookshot so that you can hookshot across as needed, as I did here. Don't worry, as soon as you take your mask off and you switch to a hookshot, the things that you can see with the mask will still be there for a few seconds before they disappear. So you have some room to quickly execute whatever you need to do, whatever moves. So yeah, oh, and we have some nice red angels here that look pretty cool. So yeah, we go back to Earth, everything's destroyed, and so we're wondering, okay, where to start? Well, we can get some information from a demon named Volgrim. So we go to Volgrim, he tells us about the tower, I think. But he tells us about Samael, who I think is going to be a very important character in the whole of the story. We make our way to Samael's tomb, and he's been imprisoned. He's been imprisoned in this weird kind of concrete thing, like a concrete prison. Anyway, we free him, and he's still kind of imprisoned in that area that we find him in. And the only way to free him, well, he tells us first about the tower, the Black Tower, and that's where we need to go because that's where Straga is. But he tells us, well, he can show you the way to where Straga is. I mean, yeah, to the whole tower and where Straga is, if we help him. And what he wants us to do is collect Hearts of the Chosen. And the Chosen are the elite demons that the Destroyer, the big boss of the game, has chosen as his, I guess, guards. So he tells us, you go kill them and bring me back their hearts. And we don't really know why he wants their hearts or anything, we just know that he wants us to kill them. And if we do that, well, then he's gonna show us the way to the Black Throne, the big castle, and that's exactly what we want. So might as well just make that deal, and we do. And so we set off and we go, and we do collect the hearts. When we go to Tiamat, she's wondering why we're doing what we're doing. And we know why, or at least we think we know why, because, well, that's what Samael wants, and if he wants your heart, we'll give it to him because he has something we need. But then it becomes apparently obvious that something's not right. As we go through the game, we start to get more and more warnings about how Samael's very dangerous. And then it even comes when we come to the fourth and final chosen with the heart that we need. She tells us that he is not guarding, or he's not there to guard the tower. That those chosen one that we're killing, they aren't there to guard the tower. They are actually there from the Destroyer to make sure that Samael is stayed imprisoned. Now this is a very important thing, because now that means that Samael has lied to us, that in fact, you know, what he said was partially not true. And it makes us wonder a bit as well. It made me wonder, it made me think, oh, okay, so you guys are here to keep Samael imprisoned, so then why exactly should I be killing you? Even though they aren't the nicest, but no one's really nice in this game, to be honest with you. They're all kind of crazy. So I don't see why I should be killing one sort of person over another. Strictly in storyline speaking, obviously it's a game and I want to kill stuff, yeah, whatever, but I'm just talking about the storyline. And that's why when it came to the last boss, Silitha, I kind of felt bad killing her, even though she wasn't the nicest, but still, like, after explaining, like, telling us what Samael was like, and basically he was more dangerous than all four chosen that we've been killing, he's more dangerous than them, like all of them put together. That's some serious kind of power. You have to think about that. And so it does make you wonder, like, okay, what, I shouldn't be doing this really, should I? Because I'm getting all these warnings. Even the shadow that's with you that was placed on you by the council, even he's kind of warning you, saying, do you think that he's going to go through with the deal that you've made with him? Is he going to let you live? Is he? What's he going to do? We don't know. Can we trust him? And I did think that probably can't trust him, because he is a very, very shady kind of individual, and he looks very intimidating. He's a very big kind of demon. Samael is also, I was reading the Darksiders comic, and I read that that Samael has a relationship. I don't know if it's just purely physical or something more, but he has a relationship of some kind with someone called Lilith, who is another demon who's supposedly very powerful. Very, very powerful. And that's gonna come up later, where something's gonna happen where I'm gonna bring it back to that. But basically, them two have a relationship, and it also kind of makes you wonder what's happening behind the scenes that we haven't seen yet. Especially with Samael's story, I wanna see how he got imprisoned. I wanna see who he was working, because he said that he doesn't have favor with the company his master keeps. I don't know who exactly, if he's talking about the Destroyer, but again, I want to talk about that, because I don't think it's the Destroyer he's talking about when he says his master, and I'll tell you about it afterwards when a certain cutscene happens. So I want to know who exactly his master is that he's obviously defying. But also, you have to think that it was perhaps his master that imprisoned him in the first place. And then you have to think, why would that happen? Why would he or she do that? Imprison Samael? There's a lot of questions that I have that I hope gets answered. It's interesting. You know, it's not like it's not one of those things where the story feels incomplete without knowing. You know, it will wrap up, I think, nicely. But there's a ton of questions. A load of them. But yeah, I want to know all of these things. There is a... Oh, my Chaos Eater did level up. I think my Chaos Eater is now at maximum level, which means it's probably I could do some serious damage with that. That's great. But yeah, we'll get onto the storyline a bit later on as well, because we still have some cutscenes to go. So we are now... This building in particular, we get the Armageddon Blade piece now, which is great. But there's a ton of secrets in this place, in this one building, that you make sure that you did get all of them. There is one chest with souls that we can might as well get, because we're here. You just have to go around where I'm going. On the higher ground. I could have actually got this on the first time we went through here, but for whatever reason I didn't do it. We get to do it now. But as you can see, it's actually coming along very nicely, where we're systematically going through. We have to backtrack. It's just you have to do it anyway to get these Armageddon Blade pieces. So, but I think that the route I'm taking is a good one, because of the fact that you kind of just go one way. You know, I'm not going through and then stopping at one point and then running all the way back. I'm going through a place and I'm going all the way to the end, which leads to another area we need to go to anyway. You know what I mean? So I think it's pretty good. I didn't really take much time. There's another champion artifact, that's always good. I didn't take too much time trying to plan it. I just kind of thought, okay, well, we'll go here first. And it kind of made sense as I was playing it through, that, okay, well, you know, the next logical place to go from here would be here. and then to this place and then that place, and before you knew it, I had basically been everywhere, and I had gotten everything. There'll probably be only one section where we actually have to go out of our way, and then we have to come back. And this is actually one of them, because in the Broken Stairs, there is, like, the Armageddon Blade is, like, right at the end of this zone. So there's not much I could really do about that. Like, you have to go there. And once you collect the piece, there's no way to go except coming all the way back. Because I don't think, unless I've missed a Volgrim location, there's no portal or anything there that can quickly take us out of here. So I guess that kind of sucks, but there's nothing I could really do about that. What I'm doing here is, as I'm making my way through across the highway, is I'm just going to ignore all these angels. There's too many angels, and it's going to take too long to just stopping and trying to kill every single one. Because look, we've got some ahead as well. We've got some ahead of us, so I guess try not to get hit by anything and die. You know, because if you get hit in midair, you might fall to your death or something. I don't know. But I didn't really have a problem. I kind of just ran through, tried to dodge as best I could, and you know, run across. If you can see that light that's on top of the building, that's where we need to go to, because that's where the Armageddon piece is, right there. You do remember when we were here before. This is when we were making our way to Tiamat's castle. We got to jump on a bird and we got to fly through, but there is no bird this time, so that kind of sucks. Go ahead and grab this Armageddon Blade piece. That's what we needed. And now this is where we just have to suck it in and, well, suck it up, should I say, and just run all the way back. I think once we get to Volgrim, I'm going to cut it there because this video is going on quite long enough. But once we start again in the next episode, we'll only have a few more places to go to, and we'll basically have everything. In the next episode, when you follow it through, it's basically you're going to have your 100% game file. Every single thing. Life Shard, Wrath Shard, Legendaries, Enhancements, the whole shebang. And to be honest, I hope it was fun for you, because, you know, I really love this game, and I actually had a blast playing through it. For my first Let's Play, you know, this had to be it. Anywho, that's it. I'll see you next episode.